Section 4, Stakeholder Management. Stakeholder management involves identifying, prioritizing, and understanding the interests of stakeholder groups, and on that basis, managing the company's relationships with these groups. This is taken straight from the curriculum, and you need to remember this definition of stakeholder management. Now, managing the company's relationships with the different stakeholder groups will require a legal infrastructure, a contractual infrastructure, an organizational infrastructure, and a governmental infrastructure. So understand these in a few words now. Legal infrastructure refers to the laws and regulations that must be followed and the recourse that a company has if the laws are violated. The contractual infrastructure is what a company has most control over, and this has to do with the contracts and agreements that a company will make with its creditors, suppliers, customers, employees, and so on. The organizational infrastructure deals with the internal systems and procedures that a company adopts, and the governmental infrastructure has to do with the regulations that a company needs to follow, and this is linked with the legal infrastructure. Mechanisms of stakeholder management. There are no standard set of mechanisms across different companies, but what you see here is a list of mechanisms that are quite common, and these are the mechanisms that you need to be aware of. Specifically, you need to know a few lines about each of these items and how these items address some major risks. Let's start with general meetings. Now, these are general meetings of shareholders, and in almost all countries, there is a law that requires these general meetings. Broadly speaking, there are two kinds of general meetings: an annual general meeting and an extraordinary general meeting. As the name implies, an annual general meeting happens every year, typically a few weeks after the end of a fiscal year. Now, the most important activity in the annual general meeting is to elect the board of directors. As I've explained earlier, shareholders own the company. They elect the board of directors, who are then responsible for overseeing the management of the company. Now, there is a risk that the board of directors gets aligned with the managers and looks after their best interest rather than the best interest of the shareholders. Through the annual general meeting and the election that takes place here, the shareholders have control over who represents them on the board. Now, there might be other items that are also voted on in the AGM, but the main item is the election of the board of directors. The extraordinary general meeting can happen anytime during the year. This meeting can be called by the company or the shareholders, and if there is some significant item that needs to be voted on, such as a change in the bylaws or perhaps a vote related to whether the company should be taken over or not, that will happen in the extraordinary general meeting. In the general meetings, there are some resolutions that simply require an ordinary majority, and the election of the board of directors typically requires an ordinary majority. There might be other resolutions that require a supermajority. A supermajority would mean that for a resolution to pass, either we need 2/3 or 75% of the votes. In the context of voting, you need to understand the term proxy voting. This is a process that enables shareholders who are unable to attend a meeting to authorize another individual to vote on their behalf. You should also understand the distinction between cumulative voting and straight voting. And I'll explain this through a very simple example. Let's say that we have two seats and we are voting for a director over here and here. Let's say for seat one, the vote is between A and B, and for seat two, the vote is between C and D. Now we have a minority shareholder with 1,000 shares. Under straight voting, the shareholder would be able to vote his 1,000 shares over here and then vote again his 1,000 shares over here. Under cumulative voting, what the minority shareholder can do is combine these two, so have 2,000 votes and vote all of them for C. Let's say that this minority shareholder really likes this candidate and does not really have an opinion on A or B. So cumulative voting gives minority shareholders a little more strength. The point I made earlier about super majority voting requirements, where we need either 2/3 of the votes or 75% of the votes to pass a given resolution, is also intended to help minority shareholders. With a supermajority vote, it becomes harder for majority shareholders to influence corporate decisions at the expense of minority shareholders. Board of Director mechanisms. As we've said before, shareholders elect the board of directors who are responsible for overseeing the managers of the company. Now, this is an extremely important function and it will be discussed in a lot of detail in the next section. The audit function. To understand the importance of this audit function, let's consider the risks that shareholders face. Shareholders are clearly removed from the day-to-day management of the company. So there is a risk that managers are misusing the resources of the company, which ultimately belong to the shareholders. There is a risk that managers are presenting financial statements that do not adequately reflect the economic reality of the company. There is the risk of fraud. So how do we deal with all these risks? These risks are mitigated through the audit function. The audit function represents the systems, controls, and policies and procedures in place to examine the company's operations and financial records. Reporting and transparency. It should be fairly obvious by now that there is a substantial amount of information asymmetry between shareholders and managers. Clearly, managers know a lot more about what's happening with the company relative to what shareholders know. Now, this is addressed through reporting. Regulations require that managers disclose a substantial amount of financial and non-financial information. This connects with the governmental infrastructure that we've talked about before. So, what is the benefit of the reporting and transparency? The reporting requirements reduce the extent of the information asymmetry between shareholders and managers. It allows shareholders to assess the performance of the company managers and directors. It allows shareholders to make informed decisions in valuing the company and deciding whether or not to invest in the company. It also allows shareholders to vote on key corporate matters. The next point has to do with policies on related party transactions. We've talked about this briefly before, but I will again set the context. Let's say that we have the board of directors and there is one person on this board of directors who has a substantial interest in a third party company, and this third party is a customer of the company. So what is the risk? The risk is that person A uses his influence to have the company sell products and services to the third party at a huge discount. Now, obviously, this is good for the third party, and since person A has ownership of this company, person A will benefit. But the company does not benefit because the company is giving an unreasonable discount to this third party. So how is this dealt with? There need to be policies and procedures to limit such a situation. And generally the policy is that if anybody on the board or even if senior managers at a company have third party interests, then those third-party interests need to be disclosed. And if there is any transaction that is taking place with the third party, then the board needs to vote on it. And obviously, the person whose interest is involved should not be part of the voting process. Remuneration policies, also called compensation policies. The issue here is that senior managers at a company might be paying themselves too much, which obviously hurts the shareholders. The idea behind compensation policies is that the compensation structure should align the interest of shareholders with managers. If managers are being rewarded for either the sales or earnings in a given quarter, then the risk is that they will have a very short-term perspective. Also, if managers are being rewarded based on stock price or stock options, then they might also be tempted to just bump up sales in the current period. So compensation policies should be designed to discourage a short-term perspective. Consequently, companies are increasingly designing incentive plans that discourage a short-term perspective or that discourage excessive risk-taking by managers. In some cases, regulators are requiring companies to base compensation on long-term performance measures. And in fact, some regulators are also requiring companies to adopt clawback provisions. These provisions allow a company to recover previously paid compensation if certain events such as financial restatements or misconduct are identified. Say on pay allows shareholders to vote on executive compensation. In some countries, such as the United States, say on pay is mandatory but non-binding. This means that the board is required to enable shareholders to vote on compensation plans or packages, but the board does not have to abide by the result of the vote. There is a debate about the benefits of say on pay. Some people argue that shareholders do not have enough information about the company operations and strategy in order to have a fair view on what executive compensation should be. The other side of the argument is that there is a risk that executives might pay themselves too much and shareholders need to have a say in terms of how much executives are paid. Contractual agreements with creditors. Now, this item and the next couple of items fall under contractual infrastructure. This is fairly straightforward. This is saying that creditors are supplying money to the company. So there needs to be some agreement between the creditors and the company. That agreement is called the indenture, which is a legal contract. This contract will have several covenants, and we'll study these covenants in detail when we do fixed income. Often the lending or the money that is given to the company is secured through collateral. And again, that is something that we'll discuss in fixed income. Employee laws and contracts are also fairly straightforward. These laws and contracts clearly define the roles and responsibilities of employees, and then also the roles and responsibilities of the company. The employee laws and contracts can also encompass codes of ethics and business conduct. Contractual agreements with customers. So these are agreements that clearly outline what the company is providing to the customer and what the company can expect from the customer. Similarly, contractual agreements with suppliers indicate the roles and responsibilities of the company and the suppliers. Laws and regulations connect with the government infrastructure and legal infrastructure that we talked about earlier. Companies need to follow the laws and regulations established by the government and regulatory authorities. Generally, the intent behind these laws and regulations is to protect the rights of specific groups such as customers or to protect the environment and so on. For certain industries such as banks, food manufacturers, healthcare companies, and airline companies, the laws and regulations can be quite strict.